Good morning. It's great to be here today. And I'm going to talk about something that is kind of foundational. I want to talk about story because I feel like in one sense or another, we're all here for that reason. We're all here to tell stories. And there's a lot of delivery mechanisms for stories that are exciting and interesting to talk about today, which we will. But I want to talk about why we're here. And that's the fundamentals of communicating who we are and what it means to be human. And that's done through stories. It's a really unique kind of language that we human beings have. And I start with this image, which is a handprint on a cave wall, and it's 30,000 years old. So somebody took the technology of a reed from a river and blew colored mud through it on their hand and ended up with this signature. And we can look at it this morning and say, here's somebody kind of calling out in the wilderness, just saying, remember me. Remember me, I was here, remember my story. And let me tell you my story, even through 30,000 years. Let me show you what it's like to be me. So those stories become really important, except the world looks like this. So the world is a big chaotic place. And how do you tell that story? Well, I like this Kurt Vonnegut quote. He says, human beings will be happier not when they cure cancer or get to Mars or eliminate racial prejudice or flush Lake Erie, but when they find ways to inhabit primitive communities. And I love that idea of primitive communities, the idea that, you know, if you're a kid having trouble with mom and dad, you can run down the street to your uncle or to a close friend. And I think in a way, the confluence of technology and entertainment can offer us all and our audience these primitive communities to reconnect with. Communities that we've never had as human beings before. But I think when Vonnegut talks about that primitive kind of connection we have as humans, that's what our opportunity is. And that's what excites me. Now, these are families, not mine, but these are families that we belong to. We're also part of not only families, but of tribes. So sometimes those tribes are literal tribes. Sometimes they're Amish tribes or sports teams. I just brought this because we had a lousy game the other night and I had to talk about it. We're members of teams. We associate with that. We dress alike to communicate who we are and what our social status is. And those uniforms mean something. They mean we're associated, we have a relationship, and we as a village are a family. We even have kind of these tribal rituals that we celebrate, whether it's birthdays or weddings or christenings, that tell us what our ethics and what our aesthetics are. Our money even tells us what our ethics and aesthetics are, who we are and identifies us. Obviously, we're about a lot of elderly white men in America, but we could also be about this. I mean, this could be our money in a different way to celebrate artists or musicians or writers. So the symbology, the symbolism of that is really important to us. I want to talk about the brain. The brain is, in storytelling, is fascinating because a lot of times we talk about left brain, right brain, but I want to talk about it in terms of old brain, new brain. Old brain being kind of the amygdala, the brainstem, the knee-jerk storyteller in all of us. The old brain that deals with fear and arousal and survival and emotion, and the new brain, which is more touchy-feely and deals with reason and experience and empathy and logic. And there's this conversation going on in our head all the time between old and new, between that urge to run and be humiliated or that urge to stay and dig deeper into our stories and be more vulnerable. So while our new brain is saying there are no bad ideas, our old brain is screaming, my ideas suck and nobody told me. Or our old new brain saying, control your fears. Our old brain says, run away, be vulnerable, be humiliated, follow your dreams, get a job, failure happens, so does shame. Everybody contributes, then they'll steal your ideas. Open up and create, shut up and survive. This is the conversation that's raging in our head all the time and becomes the foundation for so much of our work as storytellers. Now, Pete Carroll, the coach of the Seattle Seahawks, says, prepare at the highest level, practice at the highest level, and play at the highest level. If you want to play at that high level, your entire preparation has to be at that high level. And that goes for storytellers, too. It's not about talent. It's not about, oh, you have talent for storytelling, you don't. We're all storytellers. We may have lost a lot of that when we turned 14, but we all drew at one time. You used to put crayons on the table. We all draw. We all sing. We all tell stories. So we all have to prepare, we all have to understand, we all have to dig deeper, which is part of the reason you're here today. Now, when Walt Disney started out making cartoons, this is what a Walt Disney cartoon looked like around 1928, 1929. This is Oswald the Rabbit. And 9 years later, just 9 years later, Disney cartoons look like this. This is Snow White. And it was a deliberate act to take Walt's animation from this to that. It wasn't something that happened naturally. He gathered artists together, he put on a school, he put together all the elements they needed to make that transition in such a short time. So that 9-year transition between those two styles is kind of extraordinary. And these are some of the things he did. He brought in experts like the photography from Edward Muybridge. Muybridge was Leland Stanford's photographer, and Stanford hired him to photograph his racehorses. So Muybridge set up cameras every 21 inches, and back in 1878, long before film, long before Walt Disney, he filmed all these stills of humans and animals in action. And animators studied these like crazy and prepared and understood how people move before they went into their animation. They also studied artists like this. Long before Walt Disney was born, T.S. Sullivan was doing drawings like this. So that anthropomorphized look that you might think of as Disney animation was around. He was a magazine illustrator, so was Heinrich Kley. And if you look at this, you go, oh, that's kind of Fantasia. And how cool is it to see ice skating elephants? And the Disney animators borrowed heavily from these guys, and rightly so. Picasso himself said, good artists borrow, great artists steal, which is a quote he stole from T.S. Eliot. Immature poets imitate, mature poets steal, which is a quote he stole from Igor Stravinsky, who said, good composers borrow, great composers steal. This is Picasso. You look at Picasso and say, what a nut. Like, how did he paint this stuff? Where did this come from? Well, it came from Africa. Picasso was living in the south of France. France had colonized Africa, and all this great art and masks were coming up from Africa. And Picasso was painting them. And here he is in his studio, surrounded by his African art. So he's borrowing heavily from the storytelling traditions of Africa. Here's a sacrificial altar from Chichen Itza that Henry Moore, the sculptor, looked at when it was on tour in London. Loved it, was inspired by it, used it liberally. This is a Jacob Jordan's painting from the Netherlands. And here is Vincent van Gogh's painting copying it. Exactly like it, in Vincent van Gogh's own handwriting. You don't have to worry about copying too much because your handwriting's different. It's not gonna look exactly like it. Here's George Washington with a six pack and a toga. He probably didn't look like this, but on the 100th anniversary of his birthday, they sculpted this, and it was symbolic, really important, and storytelling is symbolism. Our brains are so good at associating things because it was based on this statue of Zeus, this ancient statue. And by associating Washington with Zeus, it gave Washington an instant power, an instant interest. And the Romans stole that too. They used it on Jupiter. Napoleon, when he wanted his portrait painted, stole it and used that same pose. So on your holiday card this year, if you want to look powerful, use this pose. It's really, really effective. Musicians borrow too. I'm going to play a little bit of a score from an old Ronald Reagan movie, King's Row, by Eric Wolfgang Korngold. John Williams, the composer, is a huge Korngold fan, loved Korngold, and loved the score from this movie, King's Row, which is a movie from the 30s. Let's have a listen and see if you can see where the inspiration comes from. Oh my God. Obviously, Williams is a huge Korngold fan. And if you listen to that whole piece, there's echoes of his scores from many movies in it. And that's correct. That's rightly so. You think of technology and you think, well, that's really a modern thing. We use our technology in a really brilliant and magical ways right now. But so did Degas. You know, he had these really great paintings of different angles because he was using photography long before anyone else in his paintings. And behind closed doors, taking pictures and using those in his work and using the technology of the day in his work. Norman Rockwell was doing the same thing. He'd bring people in from his town and pose them to be able to steal liberally from real life. How great is that? as storytellers and audience, we can't get enough of ourselves. We're so narcissistic as an audience. We love to hear about ourselves, and we love to see stories about other people. Here's Grant Wood. I mean, he truly is an American original, so couldn't possibly copy from anybody, except that's a painting of his sister and his dentist. And even the house in the background exists in Iowa. So even somebody like Grant Wood was using people in his life and telling stories about himself. So when the Disney animators went to continue preparing for their work, and in this case on Bambi, they brought deer into the studio and studied them from the inside out. They drew their skeletons, they figured out how they moved and what their locomotion was. We did the same thing for Lion King. We protected the animators with that little yellow police tape there. So it gave you a feeling of security. But there's nothing like drawing a 700-pound lion with nothing between you and the lion but a sketch pad and a pencil. And the results you feel in the movie, you feel the weight of those characters. This is Mark Davis drawing his wife Alice waking up in the morning. What's the ritual we go through when we wake up and using that work in Cinderella? This is Glenn Keane drawing Tarzan from the inside out. Ward Kimball, one of the great Disney animators, said, if I can take something apart and put it together, I can draw it. And the same holds true of storytelling. If I can take it apart and the motivations apart, I can tell that story. So we think a lot of motion capture technology, and it's brilliant, and we use it a lot today. We're working on a remake of Lion King right now with Jon Favreau, and we're using this technology, but it was used back in the 30s for Snow White. In the upper left-hand corner, you see March Champion dancing for Snow White in a study piece that the animators used then to rotoscope and trace over the top of and turn into Snow White. In the lower right-hand corner, 1958, the same thing was happening for Sleeping Beauty. After World War II, they shot all the animated films in live action first because we know what humans look like. We can't tolerate a human being that doesn't move and act properly and doesn't tell its own story properly. So even if it meant dressing in drag and pretending you were a fairy or fighting off a dragon on a stick, it was a way to study that work, and it's kind of the predecessor of what we call performance capture today. And it holds true today. This is a scene from Frozen, and I apologize for playing this because you'll have this song in your head all day long. A scene of little Elsa in the movie, and it's animated by this African-American guy, Bobby Pontillas. And you'll see in animation and storytelling, he can crawl into the skin of any character. He looks nothing like this character, but in this particular clip, you can see how his acting turns into that scene. Let's take a look.
Elsa? Do you want to build a snowman? Come on, let's go and play. I never see you anymore. Come out the door, it's like you've gone away.
So now he turns his video reference into really rough kind of blocking of what that scene will be.
Elsa? Do you want to build a snowman? Come on, let's go and play. I never see you anymore. Come out the door, it's like you've gone away.
And now the final animation with all the movement in it.
Snowman, come on, let's go and play. I never see you anymore. Come out the door, it's like you've gone away.
And here's the final scene with snow and final lighting and rendering on the character. And remember back what Bobby did
Elsa?
In that original study footage of himself. It's totally what he did.
Do you want to build a snowman? Come on, let's go and play. I never see you anymore. Come out the door, it's like you've gone away.
So we have to inhabit our stories. In this case, literally inhabit your acting and your performance when you create these characters.